Hello and welcome to another edition of our virtual book club. We want you to know that we're excited about the fact that you came to join us today. And we're also excited to have another great author sharing with us today. So if you would please take this moment, share this even right now, start a watch party on your page. If you like reading books, if you enjoy good wholesome content, if you have nothing else to do during quarantine but to read books now, which is good for all of us, I want you to continue to watch these enlightening interviews as we interview those authors who have not only published books, but have a story behind it. And we want to make sure that you meet them for yourselves. Today, we have sharing with us today an accomplished, established author. T.L. Blithers is sharing with us today. T.L., how are you doing on today?
I am doing well, and hello to all of the avid readers, beginning readers, and all those in between.
Yeah, doing well today. Good. So we're excited to have you with us. Won't you introduce yourself to these people? Let them know something about you.
Okay. My author's pen name is T.L. Blithers. I'm Tamika Blithers, and I'm an educator, and I've been teaching for over 20 plus years. I decided that there was more inside of me that I wanted to share with the world. In 2009, 2010, I decided to transition out of the classroom and tour with a children's book that I had written. Mm-hmm. When I toured, I met some very interesting people. And along the way, I had young people asking me, well, how did you do what you do? How did you have that faith? And so I noticed that I did not have a ready answer for them. So I had to think about it. And I came back to them and I said, well, it's all about having that faith and vowing that you make a promise to yourself to keep going. Don't stop, don't quit, no matter what it looks like. So that's how I got to this point, launching my business, meeting interesting people, and having these creative ideas. And I decided to capitalize upon this dualistic multiplicity that God has blessed me with, because we have so many gifts and talents inside of us. So I'm a teacher, educator, author, facilitator, transformational speaker, all of that. I said, okay, so let me go ahead and just help the world out with all of these gifts that I have. So that is how I made it to this spot today.
All right. In case y'all didn't hear that word, did y'all hear that word? Dualistic multiplicity, is that the word?
dualistic multiplicity. All we right. have so many gifts and talents inside of us, and it is okay if we go in and we tap into all of those industries. Because what I notice when it comes to being a teacher, it taps into so many different industries. Mm-hmm. Because a teacher is a consultant, helps people to solve problems. That's what I do.
All right. And one of those gifts that you have used is the gift of writing. How did you begin to be an author?
How I began to be an author, I teach language arts and social studies. I noticed that there was not a main character that was an African-American female that was in the foster care system. Now, we know that a lot of children in the United States or in the foster care system, and then they'll appear in children's literature, and then they're just pretty much pushed over to the side, but never a main character. So I thought about it. I said, well, what about the kids when they, what about the foster kids when they come into the classroom, the doctor's office, the therapist, the counseling office, and they see a book of a child that's going through the same thing that they're going through? And I specifically remember looking at Dr. Phil was on, and his platform was CASA, Court-Appointed Special Advocate. I had never heard of that before. And so my heart, I have a heart for foster kids. I was adopted at a young age. And so I began to learn about CASA. And that's when I decided to go through the program and to be a CASA, to be the child's voice in the courtroom. And I created this character called Mika Dika. And that is the childhood name that my mother gave me, because my name is Tamika. That was her little nickname for me. So it is realistic fiction. It's cutting and clipping from my own life, and then also what I know goes on inside of a foster kid's life, because I've had hundreds of foster kids coming in and out of my classroom. And then I noticed, I said, well, I would like for them to come into my classroom, pick up a piece of children's literature, and say, hey, I can relate to that. Because when it comes to teaching, it's all about the relevance and the rigor. So that's what happened with the idea of me writing. So after that, I decided I wanted to create a character from her teddy bear for the younger children who don't have a voice because of some unaddressed trauma that they may have gone through. Patches, Batches of Emotions. That was another book that I created. Finally, I decided that I wanted to write and co-author with other authors. Then I got with 12 or 13 other authors on a national level, and we wrote the book that's called The Whole Truth, So Help Me Teachers. So we're talking about 12 to 13 other educators around the nation sharing what it's like to be inside the classroom. We literally have to leave all of our cares and our life inside the parking lot and serve the population that we have a mandate for and on and to. After that, I got with some millionaire makers, and we wrote the book that was called God's High Destiny Women, a Business Devotional. So it's all of these women getting together and sharing their tips and strategies for women who are true and strong believers in the Word of God. Did that. And so two releases that's coming out between now and October, You Can Have It All. It's another anthology with at least a dozen women talking about how, as an entrepreneur, how we go in and we have to balance. It's this perfect balancing act. And through all of that, you can still so-called have it all. And of course, we know that everyone has their own title for the American dream, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And so one other one that's coming out that I really like is called Courageous Enough to Launch. And we're talking about entrepreneurs who are sharing their story about launching. How did they have the courage enough to launch? So that is my writing journey thus far. And so that's how I became this blossoming hybrid that you see now. And also very active in my church with speaking, transformational speaking with my classroom and also in the community. So that's how I became this hybrid of sorts.
Mm-hmm. All right, good. So 7 books, huh? 7 books total?
Yes, it's about 7. Mm-hmm. Wow. It's about 7. Yes, it's about 7, and I'm about to share with you the latest one that is literally fresh off of the press, so to speak, from the publisher.
All right, well, let's get to it. You have a new book that is out and available, and it is called Vow 9, Points of Impact. Let's talk about it.
Yes, Vow 9, Points of Impact, Transformational Guide to Greater. why did I even call it Vow? Because remember, I stated that when I was out touring with the children's book, I had to have a ready answer. And so my ready answer was Vow. I vowed that I would go in and I would achieve these goals that I had set before myself. But there were 9 things that had to be running in order for me to say, hey, I'm not going to quit. So VOW is an acronym that I created for myself to help me to have some type of what I like to call maintainable equilibrium in my life, because it's so much that's going on. And I did not want it to be just a book that people can read. You can write in this book. This is what I like about it. And so it's revelations, resolutions, and revolutions. And so the purpose of VOW is to help us with that maintainable equilibrium and to put the practice back into practical, because we live in a world where it's a lot of books, that's a lot of fluff and stuff, and people are looking for ready answers. VOW is an acronym. The V stands for vision, voice, and value. So with your vision, what are you looking at? Value, what do you value? Voice, who are you listening to? Because those 3 things right there, if you have low self-worth, if a person has low self-esteem, if they're putting the wrong things in their ear, in their eye gates and their ear gates, guess what? It's going to hinder them from achieving those goals and could possibly turn them around into a whole different trajectory in their life. So that's what the V stands for in VOW. And so the book is cut up. The book is sectioned off into 3 sections, the V, the O, and the W. And so you'll see that there's a format. There's a little story that I give, and there's an impact point, and I give questions to consider. And then there is a discussion, which I really like. The O stands for options, opportunities, obsessions. Because in life, we have options. What are your choices? And opportunities. What door has been opened to you? What window has been opened to you? And we know that there's a different feel when there's a window open as opposed to a door being open. And we have to seize those moments, the options and the opportunities. The last O is obsession. What are we obsessed about? A lot of times when we hear the word obsession, we think, ooh, that's a bad thing. If it's driven in the right direction, it can be good, because we can look up and find ourselves in the winner's circle. When we are obsessed, that means we're relentless. Because I think about when, I think it was Jacob who was wrestling with the wrestling up on the mountain. He was relentless. He was upset. He was obsessed with it. And guess what? He came down. He had a little limp, but he was victorious. So that is exactly what the O is for. The W is for word, wisdom, and worship. The word, when we read the word, it makes us wise. It gives us wisdom and it can direct us. And so we are wise to worship. So once we start thinking about all 9 points, if you visualize 9 circles interconnected, working together, those 9 circles. If you think about it, if one is out of sync, it's going to affect the other. Yeah. So anything that we're going through in life, we can step back and say, okay, what point is out of sync? Who did I listen to? What do I not value? What did I see that skewed my vision? Okay, what options, what opportunities do I have that I did not seize? What am I obsessed about? Is it something positive? Is it something negative? What word am I meditating on? And then it's like, okay, that word that I'm meditating on is making me wise. I'm getting smarter. It's making me wise. And I thank you. So that worship. So all of that is so cyclical, and it's constantly running in every areas in our lives. So that is Val 9 points of impact, transformational guide to greater. And so with Val, embedded in Val, it has three main goals. Number one, enlightenment, to awaken and sharpen your insight. Two, empowered to take action and be proactive. Three, encouragement, encourage to move forward and to be progressive. So that is the sole purpose of Val. It's no fluff and stuff. And I like how I've structured it, because with the book clubs, with the studying, it's an easy read. It's not an intimidating, thick book. It's talk, tackle, testimonial. So we'll talk about it, we'll tackle it, and then you can testify or give a testimonial about it. After each section, what I've plugged in is something that I call seeing, saying, and getting. And so with that, it is reflections, affirmations, and expectations. Because Val lines up with what you're seeing, what you're saying, and what you're getting. And once again, I love it because you're provided with all of these lines. So I love it because you can write in it. It's a journal tool that is going to be perfect for women's groups, men's groups, and the target group is like from age 8 to 108. Mm-hmm. And all churches and businesses, school districts, it can even be used at the beginning of a faculty meeting, definitely a leadership meeting, because a lot of times we are out of sync and we don't even know it. We are out of alignment. And when people are out of alignment, they go to a chiropractor. Mm. And so by going to that doctor puts us back into alignment. Mm. And so I'm really excited about what this guide is going to do. It is going to, once again, it's going to awaken, sharpen, and cause people to take action and be proactive and to be progressive. And definitely the goal is to put what? Practice back into practical, because we're always looking for something that's easy, and this is easy. And we're in a state with the historical revolution going on, and with the pandemic going on, we just don't have time to sit around and not do the work. Right. This right here helps people to do the work. And we can do the work together. And it's very practical and easy.
Good.
Val, 9 points of impact.
Good. Let's deal with some of the, when you talk about voices and whose voices are we listening to, how important do you think it is, especially in the climate we're in right now, are we to be mindful of the voices that we're listening to?
It's vitally important that we are mindful of the voices that we hear, because we're in a state, the world is in a state that it has never, ever been before. This is a new normal, and everyone's trying to navigate through it.
Right.
So let's talk about how with the voice is going to tie in with wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
And so obviously, like in the Word of God, it says listening to that still small voice.
Mm-hmm.
And that still small voice has to be positive, has to be feeding you positive information in order for you to plug it in and say, okay, so the voice is saying, I need to move left. I need to move left 10 steps. Now let me go here. Let me go there. It's very important as far as who we listen to.
Right.
And I have to admit, first of all, listening is a lost art form all within itself.
Yeah.
So we have to be careful about who we listen to, because that's going to feed how we feel. And then what it does, it creates visions, what we think it should be or what we think that it is not. So listening to the right people, mm-hmm. listening to the right people the right people. And everybody has their own definition of who's right. And so we need to think about, is it harmful? Who is it harming? And how is it helping? Who is it going to help?
Mm-hmm. Good. Talk about the opportunities. How do we maximize the most of our opportunities?
Opportunities, I think that opportunities happen in one or two ways. Okay. They happen accidentally. Well, they could happen several ways. They happen accidentally. We stumble up on them, or they're presented to us. When an opportunity is presented to us, that's when that vision and that the voice comes into place. Because you can be presented with an opportunity, and if you share it with someone, someone can talk you out of that good opportunity simply because your faith level, or they haven't been listening to the same voices that you have. They haven't been seeing, they haven't been feeding their spirit with the same thing that you've been feeding yours with. So seizing opportunities, I tell you, it's very important. And definitely people have to know that, like I stated earlier, we have to know the difference between a window of opportunity and a door of opportunity. And I even talk about that in the book. There's a different draft feel. If you think about it, you can tell when a door is open. There's a full draft. If a window is cracked, you won't really tell unless you're really in tune with the room and how and what the temperature usually is.
Good. And with us not being able to physically go to worship, how important is it to still worship even in the midst of times of uncertainty, times where it's not conducive to what you're used to? How important is it to keep that aspect of your life intact in spite of all that we're going through now?
In spite of everything that we're going through, having a sense of worship, and see, worship provides connection. I talk about that in the book. I don't want to give too much away, but worship is a connection with God, and you don't want to be disconnected. If anything, this is the perfect opportunity to be connected with them even more. Absolutely. Because there should have been, between March and now, many people should find themselves a whole lot closer, having a better relationship because of that downtime. Now, with that downtime, it goes back to, what have you been looking at? Who have you been listening to? This is the perfect opportunity. And then also, during this pandemic, it has really revealed to a lot of people how they depend on a building instead of depending on the relationship with Him. Because no matter where you are, you should be able to go in and create your own little altar to Him right there, because you should be able to step in immediately. You shouldn't have to wait for Sunday or Wednesday and check the air to make sure the temperature is just right, to check that the praise team will sing your favorite songs, and wait for the typical program to happen. No, we set the tone. We have to understand that we set the tone with our own worship and with our own relationship. That's just like in a marriage. A marriage cannot work if the man and woman, or if the two individuals in that marriage, if they're not communicating. That's what worship is. Worship is communing with Him. How do you expect Him to know you if you're not communicating with Him? That's what He wants. He wants us to communicate and connect and stay connected with Him, no matter the state of the world, no matter where we are.
Good, good, good. What advice would you give to people who have had a hard time focusing on the voices to listen to, taking advantage of opportunities, and taking heed of what they need to do in their life? What advice would you give to that person who's kind of lost their focus? How do they get that focus back even now?
And I would say, with everything going on, even the person with the strongest faith level and system can be shaken at this point. I would say, take it to ground zero. Mm-hmm. Take it to ground zero and say, okay, let me stand flat-footed right here. Let me check, what have I been listening to? If I've been sitting and watching and listening to the news 24 hours a day, guess what? I can't do that. My advice is to limit yourself around the things and people that's not feeding you positive information. That's the most important thing. It's all about staying and being around positive individuals who are for you, who are in your corner. Take it from there, point A, and you'll start seeing things start transforming. Because what's happening is we have to make a conscious decision and say, hey, you know what? This isn't working, so let me try this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Good, good, good. So, What advice would you give? You say you've written at least 7 books. You've been a part of other things. What advice would you give to those who may be watching, who are aspiring authors, who are in the process of writing books, or those who, you know, think they want to write but don't know where to start? What advice would you give to those people?
The advice that I would give to aspiring authors is, first of all, there is a need for what you have to say. It does not matter if one person is going to buy the book. Guess what? That one person, they're waiting for what you have to say. And what you have to say, it does matter. So don't talk. It goes back to that voice. What voice are you listening to? Do not talk yourself out of that book and write, write, write. Do not listen to people who have not been in that arena. They don't know what they're talking about. Go ahead and decide if you want to write traditionally or if you want to self-publish. So I would let them know, start right there. And writing, it is not hard. The hardest thing is carving out that time to actually do it. Publishing a book is not as hard as people think that it is. Many years ago, you had to sign on with big publishers and they would turn your manuscripts down and you would have to start from point A, point B. No, it's 2020 and there are a whole lot of options and opportunities out there for you, and nobody can hold back the book that God has placed inside of you. Go ahead and write it, because the world is waiting on it. That's my advice I would give to them. Mm-hmm.
Good, good, good. We've enjoyed you. Why don't you let people know how to stay in touch with you and how to get your product?
Okay. Well, my website is Upper Room Writer, upperroomwriter.com. And then also I am tlblithers.com. You can find me on social media platforms at TL Blithers Author on Facebook, TL Blithers Author Instagram, TL Blithers Author on LinkedIn and on Twitter. Also, my books, they are sold on Amazon and Vow 9 Points of Impact. Give it about a couple of weeks. It's going to be on Amazon, Barnes & Noble. Also, on my website, you will see my email addresses, tblithers@gmail.com, tblithers@netscape.net.
Mm-hmm. All right. All right. And for our final thought, give us, as an educator, with the uncertainty of, you know, going back to school and the kids, you know, being put in harm's way, how do you feel being an educator and being kind of in the middle of what's going on right now?
Yes, definitely Vow 9 Points of Impact comes into play, because the voices that we hear, the options and the opportunities, because the school district, they're giving the parents and the children and the teachers options and the opportunities to teach virtual, to telecommute, or to do face-to-face. So we have to keep in mind all of the facts, the science that we know about, make sure that we have a strong belief. Our belief system is strong and tough enough. And then also it goes back to the W in Vow, that wisdom. We definitely have to use wisdom, the social distancing, the washing of the hands, all of that, wearing a mask, all of that is going to play in with having a very successful school year. And then also with the school districts being wise also. It's all about that wisdom. And that's how we're going to be able to navigate through this historical revolution and how we're able to navigate through this pandemic by using wisdom. And be careful about the voices that we listen to and our vision, what we're watching.
Mm-hmm. Good, good, good. Well, we thank you so much for sharing with us today. I want to make sure people that you go out and you snatch up every book you can. Thou 9 Points of Impact is available now. I want you to go back and get it. Go get it. You can get it through Amazon or any place that she's mm-hmm. able to sell products. Mm-hmm. Make sure that you support not only her, but all the educators. We thank God for all those who have chosen the life of educating our children. We thank mm-hmm. God for all of them. And we're praying that God will cover all of them as they get ready for this school year, which is full of mm-hmm. uncertainty. And we know that God can keep us all in the midst of all that's going on. We pray for every educator, for every child, even now. Yeah. But I want you to make sure you support T.L. Blythers and all of her books that she has written. Make sure you continue to support this virtual book club. We are coming every Wednesday, every Tuesday at 6 o'clock every Tuesday. And we're bringing you another author every week. So thank you all for joining us. Thank you for watching. And make sure you share this even now. Everybody needs to meet T.L. Blythers. So make sure you share this even now so that she can be able to impact their lives as well. Remember, my name is Richard Holman, and we love you. There is nothing you can do about it. God bless you.
Thank you.